I really agree with you, Jessalyn. This is the political trial of the century to this point. And I just want to put this in the room because I kind of called this grouping together, and I know the national security state is of great concern to everyone, but it is also something that can lay you low. You can look at it and say, oh my God, there's nothing we can do. We're bringing the resistors here, Tom, Jessalyn, Bradley, and this is very important. But also, just to put this in the room, I am not, you know, I'm not one who thinks this is all about going against what America really stands for. I came through the 60s. Some of you did too. The Black Panther Party was killed and decimated. Friends of mine who were revolutionaries and political activists were locked up. Their lives were destroyed. I was followed by the FBI at the age of 13. My whole family was audited. This is a brutal dictatorship in very many ways. And I appreciate the sister's comment over there about how we have to understand this is all being done in many ways to keep this global reach of the U.S. in place. And yet we have to resist it. So let's let it fly. I see my friend Shahid had his hand up, and I'll call on you, and then I'll put a stack together.
Just had a question for Kevin in particular. So on your blog last week, you were writing about news organizations not getting accredited, and that there were, you know, X number of news organizations that sought access and some very vastly smaller number that got it. So two questions there. One, so to connect that to your comments about the sort of failure of the news media to grant the trial adequate importance, is there interest within the institutions? And, you know, what is, I can guess what's certainly compelling the denial of access, but why is there more outrage in media
Charlie Savage of the New York Times comes to the trial this past week, and he raised his hand and he asked the person who briefs us why we weren't being given the schedule of witnesses that were going to be testifying ahead of time. Why can't we know who's going to? And the reason he was asking was because he didn't want to be there. He was asking because they, in these institutions, these media organizations, want to look at the list of witnesses and decide who they think matters to the trial, and then only show up in the media center to cover when that testimony is being given. So I think that there's a lot of calculation on the part of these media organizations that's been going on throughout. You can detect that from the fact that the New York Times had to be shamed by the public editor, Margaret Sullivan, to actually have some people there covering. And the reality is that they didn't think the pretrial process was important, which is wrong. They also aren't sure that every single day of the trial is worth doing stories about. I disagree. I think that there's a headline every single day. I think it calls into question your ability to do journalism if you can't make something that seems unimportant important to people, because it is. I mean, everything in this trial has its own significance. Maybe it's not always going to be a bombshell like this person from the SEAL team raid that sees digital media, shows that Osama bin Laden got WikiLeaks cables. Maybe every day you're not going to have something sensational like that that you can report, but you will always have something of interest, like that exchange I read to you between C. Fulton and Mr. Coombs. So the reason I think they're not interested in creating a lot of uproar about the lack of access is because I think that they do want to go along with the rules that Fort Meade has set. And they don't want to bring that animosity into being there also. I mean, the New York Times was one organization out of all media organizations that did not cover the leaked audio statement of Bradley Manning. They did not do a story about this leak. And I don't know why. I'm not sure if they thought not covering it was going to get them special favors from public affairs officers when they were doing coverage. But they just decided not to do anything about it at all. And so I think that it's also that they just don't want to become part of the story. And then I think media are very conscious about becoming the story, and they don't want to be the story. But that is the story. The story of this trial is also what Shane Cottydall called mock openness in yesterday's panel of just this faux openness of we're going to let everybody in, they'll be able to cover everything, but we're going to hide the nuance. I just put up a quote from one of the pretrial documents that we were denied access to throughout the whole course of the proceedings, and it says, just blatantly comes out in the government's motion in response to the defense's request for speedy trial, that Bradley Manning wouldn't have been held in pretrial confinement for 18 months if WikiLeaks hadn't continued to post disclosures of classified information. Mm-hmm. That seems like a big deal to talk about in terms of them really blaming WikiLeaks for the punishment he was going through at Quantico, but we didn't get to talk about that because the military hid those court records from us so that we couldn't do the full reporting.
I should mention Shahid is the Bill of Rights Defense Committee, BORDC.org. Thank you. Okay, so, okay, I've got an order here. You first and then you.
So I'm a physician by education, and I've been following the 2009 stimulus, which has expanded all these electronic records, both in healthcare and education, and I've been just mortified as I see all the sensitive data that's going in to these records. Came this past week to DC for some privacy conferences in healthcare and had set up some appointments with my senators, Wyden and Merkley. And I went to a conference on chief information officers, one of which was a Verizon security guy. And it happened to be on Thursday. There was one quote that these corporate guys were saying is that it's getting harder and harder for them to managing the logs to extract value. The haystack is getting bigger. The ability to find the needles is not getting bigger. So that was interesting. And then the thing in terms of going to Wyden's office, I'm telling you, his LA was just like, Patriot Act. We've got to do something about the Patriot Act. And it's like as though we, the citizens, aren't complaining enough to move Congress to do something about it. So I just wanted to know if you could speak to any of these issues.
You happen to have two of the best representatives, two wonderful representatives. I mean, in my top five congressional favorites, sort of losing my voice. But people have been speaking, you need to be really loud, even louder, through whatever you can call. I live in D.C. I don't have a voting representative in Congress, but most of you do. You need to, I mean, it's really easy. They have things on the internet where it's like, call my congressman, and you literally, you know, pick out your state and send a message and say, I don't want all this surveillance. I don't want this particular law. I don't want Patriot Act. You know, be more vocal. Send letters, whatever your strengths are. Some people are good op-ed writers. Some people are artists. Some people are good at attending, you know, and have the time or retired and can attend protests. Whatever you do, whatever noise you're making, we need to be even louder. And the kind of noise I've been hearing over the last 48 to 72 hours, that's what we need. That's the kind of noise we need to be making. Not the kind of just like, gosh, this sucks. Obama's not doing what he pledged to do. God, I'm really conflicted, but like, Romney would have been worse. We don't know. We don't need that. We need people to do stuff. And whatever your thing is, if you're a blogger, if you're a writer, if you're an artist, if you're a poet, if you're someone who has, especially if you have time on your hands or are lucky enough to be, you know, retired or... You know, I tried to do this. It's challenging when you're at home with your kids or whatever. Do what you can. Bring them to protests and rallies or pick up the phone or computer and every single day send off one of those emails. Every single day go to change.org, type in what your issue is, Guantanamo hunger strike, NSA surveillance, and there are multiple petitions out there. Sign them. Add your name. Add your voice. Again, you know, why only now when it's gotten this bad? But I do believe people are always saying, is it too late? Well, I feel like we're at a tipping point, and we need to make this tip the right way.
All right, what I would just add quickly is just that It was remarkable to hear what President Obama had to say about the publication of this information by Glenn and The Guardian, and to hear him just describe the actual reality. I don't think he's wrong. He was talking about how the Congress has signed off on all of this. The federal judges signed off on all this.
Which is kind of bullshit, by the way, if I can interrupt.
Right, no, that's where I would be going. But, I mean, I think what you would add is that they rule in total secrecy. We're never able to see their interpretation of these requests for orders. So, even though a few good men inside of the Congress have pushed and tried to get disclosure, that's never going to go anywhere. And so it was remarkable to hear the reality of just how he was presenting the truth of the system, that in his statement, though he was defending them, he was also making an argument that you or I on the other side could make, that Congress is in on this, that the judicial branch of government is in on this, and then we already know that the executive branch is in on it too, but he was also saying that, look, the judicial branch and the Congress check what I'm doing, so there isn't anything to be bothered about, and if there is something to be bothered about, we have problems, is what he said. Because, and I said, yeah, we do have problems.
Tom.
My response, a democracy, constitutional republic, our form of governance cannot long endure if the most significant acts and decisions that the government is making remain in secret. It's anathema to our way of life. It's anathema to the grand experiment that was launched over 220 years ago. Something has to give, and what's giving are our fundamental freedoms and liberties. If that's the country we choose to keep going forward, then the outcome is pretty clear, because secret power will not yield willingly. And they've already taken an awful lot of what this country is all about. You want to take that back? That's going to require far more than spectator sport analysis or sitting on the sidelines, because that's what's at stake. And I keep asking the question, given the sacrifices that I made and others have made, and many people you don't even hear about, because they were not prosecuted or indicted. They suffered just as much or in a very similar manner. If that future is worth keeping, the future of liberty and freedom, then you're willing to stand up and make a difference. If not, then you deserve what you get. And that's one of the things that the Leviathan security state is taking advantage of. They're taking advantage of the fear. They're taking advantage of the divisions. They're taking advantage of the separation. They're taking advantage of all of the realities of the boogeyman, the fear-mongering, everything. We've been through this in history before. But in history, it has usually balanced itself within a few short years. We have not balanced ourselves at all. We've gone to the other extreme. And that state, that surveillance state, it's never enough. I heard the most chilling of phrases after 9/11. When I said, if you're in violation, two things, if you're in violation, right, you're in violation of the Constitution. If you believe the current laws don't work, then go to Congress. And there's a legal means by which you change law in this country. Per the Constitution. You know what I was told? They'll say no. Then they said, we just need all the data. We never know when we might need it again, but we just need all the data. We have a surveillance state with an extraordinarily deep pathological condition. They just want to know it all. And you know what the Stasi's motto was? To know everything. And that's everything about you.
Yeah. And as you said, Tom, then the overall rubric is trust us.
Right? Trust us. He wants a debate. The president, I'll challenge him to debate. But his answer to debate is, I'm going to open up yet another criminal investigation.
Yeah.
He doesn't want to debate about the message. He wants to debate about who leaked the information about what his own government. Remember, he's president of the United States. It's in the executive branch. He can argue, he can project onto Congress, yes, much of Congress is compliant. But where is he standing up? He has a special obligation, the only person in this country in a form of government, to preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution. but he's the president. So I guess he'd get away with his reinterpretation of what that oath is all about.
Right. Okay, so right here, and then I got eight other people. Okay.
What I don't think is getting enough attention are the statements that have been issued by the corporations that they knew nothing about this. And I'm wondering what the response is from some of you to that, because there's a role of the complicity of the corporations here, and that doesn't seem to be getting enough attention.
Look, those orders have a gag mechanism built into it. They can't acknowledge, because
the companies
cannot acknowledge the arrangements that have been made between them and the national security state. They're gagged. They have to lie. They have to deny. And the fact remains that in these companies, the vast majority of the company employees don't even know about this. It's kept in an extremely small circle, and in some cases, based on the knowledge I had when I was at NSA, not even the very top levels of the company necessarily know. It's hidden at a different level. It's a cutout. And no one asks any questions because there's designated people that protect it. They're in we're talking complicit with the government. Now, I'm going to raise this word once again because people don't want to raise the word. I said East Germany is a fascist surveillance state. You combine the extraordinary power of the government in secret with the biggest corporations, and not only the telecoms and the internet service providers, what do you form as a government in secret? That's a fascist state, okay? By any definition. Do you want to live in that kind of society? That's the kind of power. I spoke at the Web 2.0 summit a year and a half ago in San Francisco at the Palace Hotel. I was invited to speak. I was told later that I had made, and these are the web elites, the internet elites of the 21st century. They didn't like the message. Because they're in the business to make money. And these companies are not handing over data for free. One of the elephants in the room is it's become a profit center to sell out the information that they have about you that they hold in their servers and in their data systems. It's a profit center for them. No different than what I was told by my own boss after 9/11, that 9/11 was a gift to NSA. We're going to get all the money we want from Congress and then some. There's a whole other dynamic going on here, which is part of what I blew the whistle on inside the government, is the massive redistribution of wealth. And all of this was avoidable. We never had to go to the dark side. The very best of American innovation, Judy, was ready to go well before 9/11, would have provided secure intelligence and absolutely protected all rights and freedoms on the Constitution. But NSA deliberately rejected it. You tell me. Now, we've got trillions of dollars spent later since 9/11 on what? On what?
Just a note, if you are not hearing from World Can't Wait, if you want more information about Bradley Manning and so forth, you can sign up with Stephanie as you're leaving. I want to call on Sue Ubrey and then
George.
Okay, Sue first.
Hi, thank you guys so much.
Hi, Sue.
It's so thrilled to be able to hear you guys again. But so to me, the thing is, the NSA surveillance is just one little bit of the entire surveillance state, and that Congress has to look at it all as a whole. And part of that, to me and my organization, is the FBI surveillance and the way that FBI can do so many. And investigate you without them even thinking that you're guilty of a crime. So this court order was on behalf of the FBI, right? Is the way I understand it, even though I'm not a lawyer. And then we've got the upcoming, apparently Obama will nominate James Comey to be the new FBI director, so that does give us a wedge at least to get Congress to address surveillance writ large. But how does this relate to Comey and his role at the Department of Justice back under the Bush administration? Is there any angle there? Or?
I think there is. I mean, I know he was like this heroic figure in the whole Ashcroft hospital showdown, but whatever he did, which seemed to be noble and good, NSA still continued on this path. And obviously, FBI and NSA, even if they're frenemies, they're hardwired and, you know, they're exchanging information, the information FBI wants at NSA, and sending that court order from the FISA court over to NSA. There's interaction between them. I definitely think it should be a huge subject of Kobe's hearing, because that these programs, which have been, the names have changed a number of times. You know how Blackwater has changed its name like a bunch of times? These programs' names have evolved and changed, but he's known about it. He's been involved with it, and over a period of you know, 12 years, different administrations. So I definitely think he should be questioned vigorously about this.
Bottom line, the FBI is the one that actually brings the formal affidavit before the court. The court then orders what it orders. The problem here is it's a general warrant. General warrants are forbidden under the Fourth Amendment, right? There is no question. If you talk to even certain congressmen right now, they're actually saying that what they're seeing, this is revealed to date, far exceeds the legislative intent of the language. Remember, these are all enabling acts, okay? You got to look at history. It's an enabling act. They want to have to make legal what was patently illegal and unlawful under the Constitution. So once they do that, then they have secret interpretations of the new Enabling Act legislation that lets them go even further in secret. Now you tell me, what form of government is that? I'm going to keep coming back to it.
But in terms of the confirmation, we should not keep confirming people to positions of political power when really they should be going to jail, in my opinion.
Well, at least there should be a fight.
Right, at least.
Yeah. Earlier, Justin, you talked about, and I'm going to stand because I can't see your face.
Thank you. A little.
I'm George Friday with BORDC. Good to see you again, Tom.
Yes.
And earlier you talked about the importance of us making a lot of noise. And this is really a comment for everyone here. The congressional recess is coming up, so they're going to be home. So whether you have a good rep or a bad rep, it's the time to make a lot of noise in lots of different ways. If you've got suggestions for us, that would be great. You can also go to bordc.org. We'll have talking points available for doing an in-home visit while your senator and congressperson is home, and just make this stay on them, you know, and make sure they address it and talk about it. And the other comment, and Thomas, we may not have time to talk about this a lot, but part of what makes your making that loud of noise make more effective is if it's not just those of us who care about just civil rights and civil liberties, because this issue is connected to other issues. All that data requires lots of electricity, lots of use of resources, environmentally, data mining, and I learned this first from you, Thomas Drake, is creating environmental conditions that are horrible and a cost that is excessive. So it means you can bring in partners that care about environmental justice and rate hikes for people and electricity costs and all those other things to have a stronger group of people who are raising that level.
And that, all of that, excellent. Yes, definitely. Bill of Rights, BORDC, Defense Committee. Go there, definitely. The other thing is, this happens to be an issue where liberals and conservatives are meeting, and it's strange bedfellows, but they want small government. Conservative Republicans want small government, not Big Brother, and we want the same thing. And this has been the one issue where I feel like we've found common ground. So it's not like it's not a bipartisan thing. This should not, I know some people are trying to paint it, oh, Obama's bad. This should not be a partisan issue. This is an issue of what kind of country we are. And I think actually, you'll find a lot more support from people you may disagree with on other political issues.
Time for one, maybe two questions. Maybe.
Yes. Yesterday, Tommy Strake said that with the information that the NSA had, quote, they would have stopped 9/11 if shared, which is an astounding comment. And but you also shared it with congressmen.
Yes, I did.
As you said afterwards. But they didn't share it. It's like they collect information for the sake of collecting information.
Yes.
And it's like all of this information from Verizon and Prism, it allows the FBI to set up sting operations for their, you know, a new terrorist.
This is the picture of the new facility in Utah.
Yeah, but it's like that's perfect for them. They want to shop for a terrorist to catch.
It's not only they have the information, it's not correct that the legal regime in place allows the information to be shared and used in a way they did not need the legal regime to have used this in a way that would have essentially stopped 9/11, right?
But to add to this, I want to bring up the name of Sybil Edmonds, which, do you remember her story? She was a translator. Remembered it in all of this. She was a translator for the FBI after 9/11, and she revealed things going on there, and she ended up being, she had a gag order, and it was appalling, and sort of disappeared from, memory.
Folks, it's an American empire, okay? That's what it is. And empires do a lot of dark side activities. You gotta remember what Cheney said 5 days after 9/11, we're gonna go to the dark side. I don't think people fully appreciated what would be unleashed as a result of he was given the national security portfolio by Bush. Obama has simply extended it. It's now under Obama, it's become fully institutionalized. And that's the real threat, the clear and present danger to our form of government.
This is mainly directed to Mr. Drake. What do you think, especially from your experience working at the NSA, about things like Tor network and cryptology in general to be able to protect people's sources and activism? Is that effective or not effective?
It's more effective than not. You have to assume everything can ultimately be compromised, right? Unless you want to go into quantum computing. I used to work in this space extensively, right? So that's another part of my career. In my prior career, I used to do software code analysis. I used to be in software engineering and software development. Very familiar with a lot of the technologies. The government has, where they have put their stamp on it, they've got back doors, right? Because they need it. On the other hand, it's possible to maximize, it's possible to, well, to be prudent on the internet, it's best to protect yourself as best you can. It's no different than going outside and it might rain today. You're not going to leave your raincoat behind because it might rain. It would not be prudent to leave the raincoat in your home. So just like you go out on the internet, it would not be prudent, especially in when you're doing communication, that you'd rather not have the government look at least easily. Are there weaknesses? Yes. And is it true that with deep packet inspection and other techniques that I'm extraordinarily familiar with, much of the internet can completely compromise? Yep. General Hayden, remember, they broadcast their intentions even in public many, many years ago. General Hayden said, we need to own the net. We is the U.S. surveillance establishment. We need to own the net. What you're seeing, these extraordinary revelations of the past 3-4 days, right? An American citizen lives in Brazil. He's a reporter journalist. It's being published in a UK major media outlet called The Guardian, right? These extraordinary revelations are just a big significant window on what was happening here. And yeah, they want to own the net. That's the bottom line.
The
internet has become a threat.
What's the rain code?
Yeah. Yeah.
What do you think we
should
use?
Well, Tor's part of it. It's part of a panoply of things, right? Pretty good privacy.
PGP, right? Pretty good privacy.
There's a number of them. There's also, it's fundamental in terms of my own daily practice to use proxies and VPN where possible, and there are servers that are non-logging, okay? You've gotta be prudent. But I will be the first to tell you, if you use those, you're automatically more suspect.
Yeah.
Because you're up to no good, because you're hiding something, and this is the pathology. You hide something, you use something in which you are being who you are as a private person, in communication with someone you want to be in private communication with, that means it's suspect.
Hide my ass, reveal anonymous people's addresses. That's a VPN site.
Let's go two more.
I'm a nurse, and just even while being here today, I'm thinking out loud. But in this administration has pushed, I want to say by 2014, don't quote me, for all health records to become electronic.
And I wonder if there are implications of NSA saying that.
Anybody read the fine print as I did a few months ago when I had a minor operation, outpatient, ingrown toenail? Okay. Read the fine print. There's a national security exception. Read the fine print.
There are HIPAA laws normally to protect your medical information, but national security loopholes are being inserted into a lot of the forms you sign. You're like, oh good, my medical information is going to be private. This is good because I'm having an embarrassing procedure because I'm now middle-aged. And but yeah, I just had a surgery too. And so, yeah, but that kind of national security loophole is getting snuck into almost every waiver you sign.
Good question. And last, Bill Gilson.
Yeah, Bill Gilson, Veterans for Peace. I want to thank the both of you for sharing your very personal stories. I know there's a lot of hurt there. It's obvious. To Kevin, in the context of where we are in the last few days, with Glenn Greenwald in particular and the pursuit for Julian Assange to Bradley Manning, do you see this as a possible tipping point that it could go against the government? This could be the first chink in the armor.
The reality is that we don't have people out in the streets creating a crisis for the government. So the government doesn't have to fear the people right now. I think that it has to fear itself. I think that it has to be afraid that people inside the government are actually going to break everything that they think they stand for. I mean, I do see the fact that if we look at the larger view, you know, we have Jeremy Scahill taking around his very excellent documentary, Dirty Wars, showing that the world is a battlefield. I don't think we should not be surprised that the world is a battlefield would include turning the entire world into a massive surveillance state that the United States can keep track of. I mean, we talk about citizens in this country, whether we're being surveilled or not, can we tell? We don't know what the NSA is doing. But what is fact is that they have no reluctance to turn every single country outside of these walls into places where they are constantly surveilling citizens. And I think that has a ramification in and of itself.